Good news. After the last video where I had incredibly intense breakthroughs that was more profound than anything I've ever experienced, I went out and had to drive on the freeway of the Silicon Valley area. And I survived. It was pretty intense. I haven't been on the freeways in about a month. And I found out that things in just a month, how much they've changed here is just actually startling. I calculated that, because I'm very used to driving on the freeways around here, the vehicles are going about 5 miles an hour faster now than just a month ago. It is incredible. The average speed was 80. And the cars were passing me like I was going slow. They were going 90, 95. And changing lanes fast. And I said, wow, the intensity has been ratcheted up to an extraordinary extent. And I predicted this, that there's this war going on between, for your attention, where you put your attention, between putting your attention on adjustments, which means in physicality, making adjustments, intense adjustments, faster adjustments, between that and putting your adjustment on the light, taking refuge in the light, which is what we are doing here. So even after the most intense type of breakthroughs, I was able to drive on the freeway, and it was a little unsettling given the incredibly maniacal intensity here. I would have rather not done it looking back, but I could do it fine. I was able to do everything fine, just a little unsettled by the experience. But yeah, it's probably better not to do that. Okay, but you can if you need to. No problem as far as that goes. Now, just as a little side light here, this flashlight is really the best flashlight that I've ever come across. I'm kind of I kind of like good flashlights. And this is the Energizer flashlight. It is the Energizer flashlight. You can get this at O'Reilly's. I got this at O'Reilly's. I've seen them at like Ace Hardware and various places. It's really the best flashlight I've ever found. There's no adjustment as far as, you know, adjusting this, you know, turning it to make a wider or narrower field. What this flashlight has, it's built in where it has a wide field, beautiful wide field, and also this wonderful spotlight is already set up that way. And it's just amazing how good this flashlight is. So if you like good flashlights, I highly recommend. It's about $25. The Energizer flashlight. And you go outside and you walk outside in the dark, and it takes the fear away. It takes the fear away because the wide field lights up this whole area, and then the spotlight area just makes it, you know, makes you feel like very, very safe. And you can see hundreds of feet in front of you. It's just powerful flashlight. It's quite reassuring. So the topic of this video is take refuge in the light. Take refuge in the light. Take refuge in the light. And this is just a little symbol of taking refuge in the light. Trust the light. Trust that the light has not died. You see, the intensity of this world to make adjustments is the belief that light is now dead light. And there are simply quantities of this dead light to get. And the more you get, the better, more happy you're going to be. But there's like a limited quantity of the light, and the light's no longer responsive to us. So it's up to us to go out there and grab as much of this light as we can get for ourselves. And that's why the world is the way that it is. All right. And that's why people are the way that they are. You know, they want to get, they want to hoard. They feel that they must. This light is no longer the way it used to be, that they were able, our will was able to change the light and get the light actually died. It's no longer what it is. It's dead. Because the way that the light is in reality, and the way that it still is, but we don't realize this, we're in the state of extreme spiritual ambition, which makes us believe we're able to kill the light. The light is the way the light is actually, is perfectly responsive, spontaneously, instantly responsive to all, to the all They're the allness. There's, and that's all there is to it. So there is no such thing as needing to hoard, or, you know, needing to battle over quantities of light that are just inert. You know, it's like energy. We're battling over energy. And getting food and getting lodging and getting utilities and getting money and all this stuff as if the light were dead. So taking refuge in the light is to trust in this light fully, that it is responsive. It certainly doesn't seem that way in this world, does it? Because our purpose, our spiritual ambition, is to believe that we can change the light. And so we're working to adjust to this situation where we have all this inert light. It's now like dead, limited quantities. It's just this inert, it's this energy that we can fight over and get for ourselves. And what we get, you know, others miss out on. There's a limited quantities of everything, of this light. So the goal is to take refuge in the light. Trust the light, trust the light, trust the light. And I'm trying to do that, and I'm trying to encourage others to do it as well. The more that do it, the easier it is for everybody else. This realm, electromagnetic realm, gives the appearance that the light is dead, but it's not really dead. But certainly it's pretending to be dead. It's pretending to be dead because we asked it to do this for us. So it seems that the haves and the have-nots, you know, all this seems to be very real, what's taking place. Now, Jesus told us, don't worry about tomorrow. Look at the lilies and the flowers, how they neither toil nor they spin. You know, they're not worried about they said, God will take care of you. The light will take care of you. Well, that is if you take refuge in the light and you know you drop your spiritual ambition, and you accept that light did not die, then certainly we believe, we have faith, the light will take care of us, because it is absolutely responsive, totally responsive. But if we're still trying to win this battle here of resources, of this supposedly, you know, dead light, then certainly we can also lose. We can also end up on the losing end. So what we really need to jump out of is this winning and losing thing. And even this sharing thing is still saying, like, well, we got limited resources, but if we just learn to share better, we can all survive. That's also the same story, limited resources. What need is there to share in reality? Everybody has exactly whatever they desire. So, right? And so this whole thing about, well, the option, we need to be more cooperative, we need to be more sharing, we need to make sure we distribute things fairly to make sure that everyone gets enough of these limited resources we have. This will all be very humanitarian. For instance, the Pope, you know, he is a very humanitarian person. I give him high marks for being humanitarian, absolutely. But I was under the impression that his business is salvation. And it's got nothing to do with salvation. I don't hear the Pope really responding to salvation in the slightest bit. But as a humanitarian, absolutely. I mean, I applaud the Pope's humanitarian actions. But what does that have to do with salvation? Absolutely nothing. So, you know, that's just how it is. It's not going, it doesn't really help. Humanitarianism isn't the answer. It is not the answer. There's no such thing as limited resources. How could light be limited? Does light say, well, you know, I think I've responded enough to you, so that's it. I'm not gonna respond anymore. What kind of light is that? That would be dead light. The light of God, does the light of God say, Son of God, you know what? I gave you this experience, I gave you this, and you want more of it? No, you know, I'm tired. I don't think I should give that to you. I don't feel like it. Or maybe you should do something else. I'm not gonna do that. What kind of light is that? That's not the light. That is not the light. That's a fantasy of the light, of the light being dead. The light will give us whatever we want to experience endlessly, without any fatigue, without any judgment, without any problem whatsoever. So the whole premise of humanitarianism is a false premise. It's a false emphasis, is what my issue is with the Pope. It's a false emphasis. It will lead to conflict. It will lead to conflict. It's not preaching the gospel. It's not being a good shepherd of Christ, which means, you know, the light, anointed, the anointed one, anointed with light, the one who is the light. The light of the world. Jesus said, we are the light of the world. That is, we are the light. Absolutely, we are the light. There's only light. How can we not be the light? And there's only the living light. There is no other type of light, actually, even though it seems otherwise, because we asked the light to appear to be dead. So it faked its own death. It is appearing to be dead. And so we have all this humanitarian concerns here. Now, there's no reason to neglect humanitarianism if you feel that that's what the light is asking you to do. But the most humanitarian thing we can possibly do is to preach the true gospel of salvation, which is to take refuge in the light and to point out the life only faked its death. It did not die. And our spiritual ambition is the problem. And our spiritual ambition is waiting, which means thinking the light that is not responding instantly. We need to wait for what we want. We need to wait for what will happen. We need to take action, which means waiting. We need to take action. What kind of action do we need to take to get the light to take action, really? Taking refuge in the light is saying, I don't need to take any action in order for the light to take action, to fulfill my requests. If we say, wait a minute, light, I need to work to fulfill this request here by getting a bunch of resources and getting on, you know, working hard, getting resources, we're saying that the light is not responsive to us. It's not truly responsive. It must be dead. If it must be dead, it can't be responsive. We must then struggle to survive. The idea of struggling to survive is insane. You know, it's based on the false belief that light died. It's spiritual ambition. It is our spiritual ambition. And this world it's not really a world at all, but this, the belief that there is a world where we have to struggle to survive, is just a picture, a fantasy of spiritual ambition, is all it is. And people cherish that. They think, no, this world's really amazing. It's a very, like a bizarre, like you go into Disneyland, you go into some bizarre ride or something, you go in there and just everything is completely bizarre, and we're like, wow, this is a really bizarre ride. You know, Pirates of the Caribbean, and just, you know, it's just really bizarre, isn't it? Well, this world is like that. It's like going on a bizarre trip in an amusement park, actually. You see all these survival, everyone's desperate to survive. And of course I feel that myself, because that's the world has, you know, pressed that upon me. It says, this is your life. So the world said, here's your life. And I say, wow, I don't really want that life. No. So taking refuge in the light is our aim here. It's really our aim. Vision of oneness is what we experience. We become aware, oh, there's only a universal being. There's just this universal being. All is universal being in the light. All is universal being in the light, and there's nothing else beside that. This is all just a whimsical fantasy dream that we've been having. But here, whatever happens, everyone insists that you account for it by process of this dead light. How did you make this dead light give you what you've got? What is the process? Break it down. You know, what kind of solvents did you apply to it? How did you get it? How did you get it? In other words, you just can't manifest something. Because they say, no, how can you get it? Where is the dead light that is involved in all this? And what process did you use? And what legal rights do you have to this, what you own? And we need to tax this. We need, you know, all this stuff. If you just manifest whatever you want here, which you should be able, should happen, not you, man, the light just should manifest it for you. You simply ask and you shall receive. the world will go bonkers. They say you can't do that. That's against the laws of the universe. Against the made up laws, fanciful laws, based on the belief that light died, which is a false belief. Based on believing that the light died, it staged its own death. It faked its death to make us believe that it died. So of course we believe that it died, but it didn't. So of course we should, manifestation should be the law of, it is the law of all of this universe, of all universes. Manifestation is the only thing that's happening. There's only manifestation happening, actually. But to our perception, it doesn't seem that way at all. We don't see it that way at all. So I keep waiting for manifestation to happen in my life. It doesn't seem to happen. It doesn't seem to happen. Because there's just this relentless insistence in this universe that you can't function that way. It's impossible. And if you do function that way, you're like a persona non grata. You know, it's like you can't do that here. You can't do that here. We don't allow that here. This is we want to have this ego trip of believing that we killed the light. See, we killed the light. That's the ego trip in this universe, especially talking about this world, which is not actually a world. The ego trip is we killed the light. And so everybody's here ego tripping on this dream that they killed the light. Yeah, someone's just manifestation happens. They just say, wow, that's a dream. That's not real. That's not true. You're a kook. You're crazy. Stuff like that. Nevertheless, we are told we can't take refuge in the light, and we must take refuge in the light. And I just hope the light will, manifest in a way that still seems in accord with what most people feel they have to see here, or else they're crazy or insane or even worse, about to be annihilated. Because everyone, the premise of this experiencing here is that the light died. So somehow the light has to manifest for us and still seem as if it's dead to some extent. That's the situation. I mean, we should be able to just drive cars and have the gas tank remain full. It just manifests gas. We want gas, the gas is there. But the oil, the gasoline companies wouldn't like that, They want to make profits, you see. They say there's limited resources. We're winners, we're winning this. And it makes us feel more secure because we feel like we're getting a larger amount of the limited dead light that there is. So we got to charge money for the gasoline. It's a lunatic asylum here, to put it mildly. But it's causing me too many troubles because I'm not able to really go out there and fight for the dead light because I know the light is not dead. So I'm not able to compete, physically for money, for resources. It just, I have no motivation to do so. I say, no, this is ridiculous. I don't believe in it. Maybe we have to shift to a higher realm, in order to function this way. This world may not allow it. I don't know. I need to find out this in a big hurry, actually, because the intensity in this world is going towards more and more denial, more and more spiritual pride in what making adjustments, the ability to adjust the dead light. They say we have ways that we can be happy, we can get more of a dead light to you, we make sure that you got a steady stream of a dead light. We can, but all the while, home prices in the Silicon Valley are beyond ridiculous. $2 million for little shacks if it's in the right place. And who in the world can afford that? Only like extremely small amount of people on the face of this earth can possibly afford such insanity. How fair is that? That's not fair. That's the law of the jungle here. So the law of the jungle is alive and well. The haves are just decimating the have-nots, all the while talking about how their incredible plan to make everybody happy. Now, California has this unbelievably bad drought. Okay, I'm telling you. And I'm also tell you, the people here, that in spite of urgent requests that everybody reduce their water consumption by 20%, that in the Bay Area, which is this bastion of supposedly liberal, progressive, social-minded people who are all environmental friendly for the planet, they've only reduced in the Bay Area water consumption 2%. Nobody is doing anything about it, really. A few people, okay, I've noticed a few people, applaud them. And we're doing a lot, I'm doing a lot here, actually. No garden, no vegetable garden this year. I'm taking out the flowers and I'm just gonna put in bark. We've cut the watering way down. We don't have any lawns. Catching the water from showers and flushing the toilet with that water, catching the water in the sink and using that repeatedly for washing washing dishes, on and on and on and on and on. You know, so many things we're doing. I put bricks in the toilets to reduce the volume of flushing the toilets. So we've cut way back on our water consumption, letting the yard dry out, essentially. But if you go around the Bay Area, you would think that everything's lush, everything's verdant, but we have all the water in the world. You know, it's like bizarre. Maybe they'll start manifesting water, you know, which you certainly can do, which is why prayers do work, actually. Prayers do work, because what it is people being a little more determined to say, hey, let's cut through some of the red tape of this universe here, of our beliefs, and let's appeal directly to light, let's take refuge in the light, and ask for manifestation here. So praying for rain actually does work, can work, but also, the more materialistic a world gets, the more likely you are for things to get chaotic, because they don't want prayer to work. They don't want prayer to work. They want to believe the light died. So they say, you're crazy. What are you praying for? It's ridiculous. Now, really, we don't need to pray at all, because everything light is instantaneously fulfilling our requests. But we can always change what we're asking for. And so in praying for rain, we're making a conscious effort to change our desires. They say, you know what? We really desire that it rains here. And breaking droughts is, of course, scientists say, oh, that's absolute nonsense. Everything is controlled by the oscillation, the ocean, temperature oscillation, Southern Pacific Oscillation, whatever they call it. But that's also entirely the light. All is the light. So you can make it rain. You can manifest whatever you want to manifest. But in this universe, there's massive taboos against it. So it doesn't seem to work very well. Christian Science was, very profound teaching, actually. And it still is. Back in the day, when that was very much in vogue, what it's basically saying is, all illness is really your simply belief that there's a lack in the light, that light's response is lacking. And when you accept that light's response is not lacking, the illness will simply go away. It'll simply go away. This is pretty much fundamentally what they're talking about. So it's really based on truth. And there was a just tremendous amount of healing by Christian Scientists who would simply sit with someone who was sick, and they would just assert that there is no lack of responsiveness in the light. The light is totally and perfectly responsive to all requests without any judgment whatsoever. And so therefore there is no lack of responsiveness. It doesn't exist. The light did not die. And the Christian Science healer would simply hold that thought, hold that knowingness in their mind, and the ones who were with them who were sick would get reassured by that. And they say, oh, I am reassured. I realize, the light really is responsive. I don't have to make adjustments to it. I don't need this illness, which is a symbol of my belief that the light died. It's a symbol of it. I don't need that symbol anymore. Healed. There were tremendous number of healings from every kind of illness impossible. Look at Jesus simply walking past people, they were healed just like that. Leprosy, blind, crippledness, every kind of ailment, just healed like that. That's true. Absolutely true. The presence of the light, knowing that it is the light, knowing that it's perfectly responsive, knowing that nothing ever happened, that absolute pure knowing, without any doubt whatsoever, without any spiritual ambition to try to change the light whatsoever, reassures to such an powerful extent that people with the most terrible afflictions can be instantly healed. For instance, leprosy, eating their body, gone, gone. You could even be raised from the dead. Absolutely. Death is just another symbol of our belief that the light died. See, the light is not no longer the light. That too can be instantly healed. There's nothing that cannot be healed here. No affliction. And yet, so this society is rapidly anti the light, actually. Is rapidly anti. It's totally pro-technology, you see. No. We need to put you in a hospital and hook you up to 20 IVs and pump you full of all these medications and spend millions of dollars, whereas a Christian Science practitioner could heal the same affliction for free. Quickly, easily, actually. Now you get prosecuted if you do faith healing. It's a criminal charged with murder if the person that you're helping, reassuring, decides they don't want to be reassured, and then the healing doesn't take place. Then they charge you with murder. But how about when someone goes into the hospital with severe condition and they die in the hospital? Do people get charged with murder there because what they were trying to do didn't work? So it's a very uneven playing field at this time. It's a war. It is a war. And I think Christian Science shows how vicious this war is, of trying to, you know, destroy faith healers, to try to get rid of people who trust in the light, and trying to help others trust in the light as well. As if they don't have 100% success rate, they should be driven out of business. Whereas all the pharmaceutical and medical complex, they can have as much failure as they want. They never even apologize for it. The surgeons carve somebody up. They say it was a successful surgery. The patient dies a couple weeks later. No one says a word. So it's lunacy here. It is sheer spiritual ambition and arrogance and pride that is at work here. And this is what we call a planet. That too is sheer delusion. There's only all is universal being. All is one universal beingness. There is nothing else. The light is totally responsive, perfectly responsive to all. No favorites. There are no favorites. Light plays no favorites whatsoever. And this is the root of trust. This is the root of our happiness, our bliss, knowing there's no such thing as favoritism in reality. Light supports all equally, forever. How can we feel insecure under those situations? But here in this world, it seems just the opposite. The light plays favorites all the time. And so we're very upset about that. Take refuge in the light. So, we have to continue to take refuge in the light. I had a dream just a couple of nights ago where my whole body was like a lamp, and when it was dark, and suddenly someone hit a switch, just pressed a switch, click, click, that switch, and the lamp lit up. The whole body just lit up. The lamp lit up. I was like, wow. Jesus said, don't hide your light under a bushel. You are the light of the world. Well, it seemed like, you know, I had darkness, not believing in the light, believing the light was dead. And then suddenly the light, my whole body was like a lamp lit up with light. Maybe that's what's going to happen, I don't know. But everyone's going to call 911 then. You can't have someone who's shining with light. You can't have that. What is that? That's some alien or something, you know. No, we are the aliens, actually. You gotta understand that we are the aliens. The world, this people, the world are the aliens. They think that they're alien to the light. I think that light is alien to them. Really, we are the bizarre aliens that we've been searching for. We don't need to search for bizarre aliens. We are the bizarre aliens. This is true. We are absolutely the bizarre aliens here. Totally. Totally. I mean, can you imagine one who knows the light looking at this world? Can you imagine? I mean, utter lunacy. Total insanity. Sheer insanity. Beyond bizarre, actually. And yet we think that we're normal, adjusted. This is normal. No, we are the bizarre aliens we've been looking for. No more need to go searching for aliens, although there are aliens everywhere. But, you know, if you want bizarre aliens, look no further than right here. You can go out any place and get your fill of them, actually. We shouldn't even have to see bodies at all, actually. Bodies are just a symbol of the belief that light died. We should just be able to see light. It can have the shape, a form of a body, a beautiful ball of light. Because that's what's really true. That's really true. The light is with everyone. The light is with everyone. It's all with all. And so we shouldn't even have to see these bizarre aliens that we call bodies. All bodies are bizarre aliens. Totally. Bodies are completely bizarre. Completely bizarre. Incomprehensible. Incomprehensible, actually. And yet we think this is completely normal. Utter madness. We are the bizarre aliens we've been looking for. So maybe it's time to take off the mask, the masquerade, this, you know, the dark, turn on the light. We are the light. All we have to do is turn it. We've asked the light to pretend to be dark. But we can say, hey, light, no need to pretend to be dark. And then the light will go on. The light will go on. Just like flicking a switch in a room. The light is there suddenly. Just there. Silently there. The intensity of this effort, I can feel it. My body's just, really buzzing and humming and feeling stress and strain. It's a real workout. It's a real workout. So we might say, I'm tired of seeing bizarre aliens, actually. I just got tired of seeing bizarre aliens on this amusement park ride. So I just decided to see things the way they really are. I got tired. I got scared. I got a little kid in the Pirates of the Caribbean. I go, Mom, I'm scared. You know, Dad, I'm scared. I don't like to see all these pirates. This is really weird. It's scaring me. So I just want to see angels instead. Angels of light or something, you know. And the parents say, no. You can't imagine that. You got to see the pirates. And the kid says, no, I'm scared. So if the parents are nice, they'll say, okay, you can see beautiful angels of light if you want to. Why don't we just say, hey, I'm tired of seeing bizarre aliens and this bizarre alien world. Again, this world is actually, it is a totally bizarre alien world. Absolutely, are you kidding? Absolutely bizarre. And to say, we're tired of it. Enough's enough. Enough's enough. I've had enough of this long, strange trip. We don't have to leave the place. We can just see it as it actually is. See a lighted world. We can see a lighted world. It doesn't have to be a bizarre alien. We can see it. We can see that all is universal being. All is the light. All is the light. We can see that right here because it's true. We don't have to have this bizarre alien fantasy, alien bodies, alien world, alien beingness, alien light, all this stuff. It's not necessary. But the laws, you know, are getting vicious. But even then, Jesus said, when you walk in the light, you need not fear darkness at all. He said, you can't touch a hair on my head if it weren't that I would, that'd be my request that you do so. Being the request of the one beingness to give us a teaching, help boost us, you know. But otherwise, no, you can't touch me. So really, laws should not be able to touch anyone of the light, should not be able to, you know, intimidate or do anything. And yet we're cowed by it. We're cowed by it. And this world is getting more and more intimidating in that direction. And even if you're not cowed by it, most people are, and they say, whoa, I can't go along with that. So you wonder, well, how come shining beings of light don't appear in this world? Well, who would have the courage to go along with that, you see, and say, hey, I want to put my attention here? Not many. They'd say, I'm going to lose my job, I'm going to, you know, be a bum on the street, I'm going to die of deprivation, people will hate me. And Jesus said, look, if the world hates you, just keep in mind it hated me first. We don't want to be hated here. You know, no one wants to be reviled and mocked. No, I don't want to. So maybe that's why the light beings don't show up, because we don't want them to. Even if they did show up to you and you told the world about them, they'd say, you're crazy. You have some mental disease. Let's do a CAT scan on you. But nevertheless, the next couple of years we have to sort of take a hiatus from all this concern and say, well, you know, maybe in a couple of years we'll revisit this and we'll see if we're going to allow you to take any reprimand us in any way. But we're going to have this sort of retro vibe going right now, sort of a retro spiritual vibe going in the world. We're going to get back to that, you know, Christian Science. We're going to get back to the, you know, the truth that Jesus gave us. We're going to get back to the great gurus, saints, sages, mystics, avatars, you name, you know, all the great incarnations. We're going to get back to the light as the light. We're going to get back to manifestation. So there's a little retro vibe we got going here. Now, in a couple years, we'll revisit the situation. But in the meantime, no, you know, hands off for a couple years. You know, if they say, well, we want to persecute you. No, not yet. I can't do it yet. Maybe in a few years we'll take another look at it. You have to have that attitude. Because the ego will come to you. The spiritual ambition, really, will come to you and say, hey, you can't do that. I'm going to force you to not do it. And you just say, no, you're not. I'm not interested in that. I'm not buying that. I'm not requesting that. They try to intimidate you into requesting it, because it won't happen unless you request it. So you just say, no, I'm not interested right now. But maybe come back in a couple years and we'll revisit this again. That's all. Do not attempt to categorically say never, okay, here, to spiritual ambition. That is what gets us into trouble. I believe that's what got me into trouble. Because the continuity problem becomes too severe then, and they'll pressure you in such a frightened way that it your compassion says, wow, okay, I'll make the request. It's too much for them, and you really feel it, because they're absolutely frantic, out of their minds frantic, that they're going to be thrown into an abyss forever and annihilated. So do not say, no, never, I am going to be we're going to do this forever, and that's it, you're out of luck. That's going to backfire on you, because of our own continuity fear and compassion that we have. So we'll simply say, look, you know, I'm not saying no to you at all. I'm not saying no to your request. I'm simply saying not yet, not yet, not yet. We'll revisit it in a little while, okay? For a little while, and then we'll talk again about this. Okay, then they don't panic. They say, wow, well, I don't like that, but okay, yeah, I'm gonna come back. I'll be waiting. You say, okay, no problem, no problem. And be honest, say, sure, sure, it's not a problem. If you wanna bring it up again, you can bring it up again. And just right now, I'm not going to address this at this moment. We'll address it in a couple years if necessary, okay? And that's it. Don't like say, no, I'm never gonna do it. I'm never gonna answer your request, or no way, you know. Don't press it like that. Just say, no, I'm not entertaining this right now. A couple years from now, you can try again. This is acknowledging the continuity fear and being compassionate. And hopefully this will allow us to live in the light for the next couple years. And then don't look past that. Don't look past that. Just get used to living in the light. And just understand that when the pressure comes on you, you just say, well, no, I'm not entertaining this request at this moment, but and maybe a little later, maybe a little later. It's just maybe. He doesn't say no. You say, well, maybe. Well, I mean, I'm not entertaining the request right now, but maybe later, you know, maybe later. And just leave it at that. Don't be totally, you know, idealistic here and insist that this is how it's going to be forever and you're out of luck, etc. The people can't handle that here. The mind's spirit can't handle it. Cannot handle it. This is the best advice I have from long experience here, trying to figure out why we have such trouble, is trying to change other people's minds and thinking this is a permanent thing. It doesn't work here. It doesn't work. You have to account for the continuity fear that people have, which is extraordinarily severe. And you cannot make it seem like a permanent, eternal situation. You have to let them feel like they can at least, that they can, you know, come back to this and again state their, you know, request. So they don't feel like they have to accept this permanently. They just have to accept a postponement of their request, like a postponement of it. Not yet, not quite yet, not quite yet. Maybe later, not now, but maybe later. So just do that. If somebody comes, they're, you know, trying to really completely intimidate you, you just say, well, not now, but maybe later, okay? Not now, maybe later, that's it, end of story. And so, in order for me to get back on track, I have to accept this for retroactively to everything, because I think I made a bunch of efforts to push this agenda too harshly here, too adamantly, and people responded with such fear that they got me to agree to their request, because I realized, wow, they can't handle this. And I was not able to forestall it in the proper way, handle it in a diplomatic way. And so that I ended up then, you know, fulfilling their request of the light, that the light appears not to be helping me. You see that? That's what happened. So, We can allow the light to help us, and people say, well, we can't do that. And they say, we want you to stop, and say, well, I'll tell you what, we're not entertaining this request at this moment, but come back in a little while, a couple of years, and maybe then we can talk about it then. Be diplomatic about it. You have to be diplomatic here. And I was not diplomatic, and that's what got me into trouble here. The more diplomatic you are, the more helpful you can be here. And my problem was, I'm not diplomatic enough. The great teachers are extremely diplomatic. very amazingly diplomatic. Just I can't believe how they're able to say, sure, we'll look at that in a little while, you know. Absolutely, we can look at that in a little while. Maybe we'll be able to look at that. Yeah, I know. And meanwhile, you know, what about this? You know, they're just able to keep this really soft, gentle diplomacy going all the time. And kind of, you know, to tell people just put your demands off just a little while, a little ease up, a little bit, and they're just able to constantly be diplomatic that way. Whereas I was like, you know, no, this is the truth, and that's it. And people here cannot handle that. They cannot handle that. So maybe there's hope for me if I go back in my life and change all my agreements that I've made with everybody and say, and I'm now changing all these agreements temporarily. Okay, so I've got to be diplomatic in doing that. So I'm temporarily dropping these agreements that I made. However, I say, you can come back in a couple years and we'll revisit this and we'll see whether or not I'm going to reinstate the agreement or not. We can do that in several years, but not now. Right now, I am, you know, revoking all these agreements that I made. But just temporarily. It's a temporary thing. Don't get nervous. It's just a temporary thing. And so we're not, and there's no discussion at this point, but maybe in a couple of years we might be able to revisit this and discuss it, you know. So it's possible I can go back my life, and you can too, we can all do this, and diplomatically revoke all of the agreements we made to function here as if the light was not responsive to us. But diplomatically, we do it diplomatically so it's not a continuity shock, meaning that others don't freak out. We say, wait a minute, you can't do that, you know. You're telling me you're going to revoke this forever? No, talk about it. It's just a temporary situation for right now, and it's going to be last for a little while here, and then we'll maybe revisit your request at that time. See, that's the way you got to be. So it might be possible to revoke the agreements I made and function here as the light, you see. The function as the light is responsive. Because right now I'm not functioning that way, actually. Just a little bit. Because of the agreements I made. And I don't know how to, you know, alter those agreements because I'm so upset about it. But I have to realize there has to be compassion, there has to be wisdom here to help out. You have to understand the intensity of the continuity fear in this world is absolutely off the charts. People are extraordinarily frightened that they think the light died, and the idea of realizing the light didn't die, it just blow their minds completely. They don't feel they can deal with that at all. And they feel that you're telling them otherwise, that they're gonna lose out on this battle for the dead light, all this dead light resources, energy, and they gotta fight for it. With total conviction that they have to get this, otherwise they're gonna die. And to feel like you don't need to do this, they feel they're gonna die, you know, be homeless and all this stuff. So it is possible, I'm just feeling it is possible for me to revoke all the agreements I made. Null and void, for now. It's a temporary easement. It's a temporary easement of all these. It's a temporary stay on all agreements that were made here to not function as the light, not function as the light being totally responsive to me. Temporary stay. We've temporarily stayed these agreements until further review. And further review will be in a couple years. We will revisit this. And maybe revisit this. Temporary stay of all these agreements, temporary restraining order, how do you say it, where the decision is stayed, or somehow, you know, it's no longer in effect, but it hasn't been completely revoked. All right, so there's ways to make it, to ease it up. And then maybe I might be able to breathe and function here again. I can certainly understand all of this, but as far as functioning, in the world. I'm still not able to do that because of agreements I made not to do it. I agreed not to do it because I pressed people too hard and they insisted that I never do it here. Because I insisted that I wanted to always do it here. So they came back with, we had never. So if I say, well, I'm going to do it for a couple years, you know, then maybe they will say, well, yeah, they won't freak out so much. Be able to get that, I'd be able to insist on that. So we can try this. This might be spiritual healing right here, actually. So we're not demanding any changes in society. We're not demanding any changes in laws. We're not demanding any changes at all. We're just simply saying that temporarily we're going to function as the light being, you know, very responsive to us. And we'll revisit any objections. We'll revisit any objections. We will, maybe we'll listen to objections in a couple years. Maybe we'll hear these objections. Right now we're not going to list them for just a short period of time, but we will possibly listen to them in a little while. But we're not demanding any changes in society or anything. We're not trying to tell everyone that they have to fundamentally alter culture or society or anything like that, because it won't work that way. They are so frightened, they feel they need all these defenses. So what you have to do is say, well, all your defenses are fine, no problem. It's just I'm going to be functioning in this way for a little while. And then we'll hear your objections to this in a little while. Not yet. Then they kind of go, okay. They're not happy about it. But maybe they're relieved, you know, relief, like, oh, okay, they're not going to take my defenses away from me. Now, if you insisted on taking all defenses away, they would just go to a different place altogether, and you wouldn't be able to even talk or contact them. They wouldn't even see you. They wouldn't even be aware of you, so you wouldn't be able to really help them, actually. So if you want to help those who have a severe continuity problems, you have to be diplomatic. So I hope I've learned, I'm right about this, because I need to be able to function actually at this point in time. These agreements are actually dragging me down absolutely into complete failure here. So this has been very helpful actually. This is a breakthrough of monumental proportions. I thank everyone who has contributed in any little way to this overall concept and idea, like, wow, you know, maybe we can do this. Maybe we can temporarily stay all such agreements that we've ever made. Just insist on it right now. And again, in a very soft diplomatic way. Temporary stay subject to further review. That's all. Temporary stay subject to further review, slated to be reviewed in maybe a couple years. No problems. See? I gotta try it. Yeah. So, we carry the light with us. See, the light is responsive to us, is it? Right, it is responsive. And those who disagree with it, we don't try and pressure them. We just say that, well, there's a temporary stay on any agreement not to function this way, but it's a stay based on a possible further review in a couple years' time. We'll revisit it at that time and see whether the stay remains for a little while more or not. We will at that time. We're not going to talk about it now. We're not going to spend the next 2 years talking about it. I'm saying definitely after a couple years we the possibility exists that you can ask again about the stay. Okay, but right now I'm not going to entertain any talk about it, but maybe in a couple years we can entertain some talk about it if necessary. Okay, so he's like that. So be diplomats of the light. We need to be diplomats of the light here. Hopefully it'll work, and I'll turn on the light, and the whole body will be lighted up. And it'll be a very good wide field of light with a nice spotlight. Do it, and hope everybody else does that too. All right, live in the light, abide with the light, live as the light, take refuge in the light. All is the universal being. All is the definition free, need free, adjustment free. Universal being that is right now, that is right now. All is the need-free, death-free, adjustment-free, universal being as it is right now. All is universal being 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 right now. And that is universal being right now.